spotlight is on Julius Randle. The question is, do you think he can be the guy to be the leader of this team, the number one option?
100%.
If you talk to some Laker fans, they'll say, like, damn, they regret letting
him go. They like Randle. Yeah.
They regret letting him go.
He's a good guy.
He's got a chance now where everything didn't fall the way people thought it would. Yeah, he's now in New York City, and he's the best player on the roster.
Yeah, yeah.
He's got a chance now to change how his career could go.
All right. Final question of the night. We didn't get KD. We didn't get Kyrie. We got Julius.
The better player.
We might be the only.
I'm Homer hard right now.
Yeah, man, let's go.
Homerism it is, right? Because the league kind of shitted on that deal.
They
didn't really give us credit for it.
And you know, it's kind of crazy, right? Because had it not been this free agency class,
yeah,
you get a guy like Julius Randle at 24 off the season he just had. That's a great, listen, I'm telling you, that's a great contract. When I saw it, I'm like, I can't believe that. I thought you would have to max him. Or at least get him the years. Get him more years at least.
I thought we were going to have to overpay.
Yeah, because even, I'm going to be honest with you, when he left the Lakers and I was like, oh, should we get Julius Randle? I think I remember saying last season, I was like, oh, he's going to be a little too expensive because of what he did with the Lakers. And, you know, I don't know if we can afford him.
Right.
And he signs the Pelicans for like $9
million. He did that for 1 year,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. So I was just like, whoa, wait a minute. He signed it for $9 million? Wait, what? What? The Knicks didn't call him? Wait, what? Yeah. That kind of felt stupid. So now that he's here on a reasonable deal, he's like, oh, okay.
KP's gone.
Yeah.
No Melo drive. There's nobody. The spotlight is on Julius Randle. So the question is, do you think he can be the guy to be the leader of this team, the number one option?
100%. This isn't even homerism. I got a breaking exclusive. We were at the I was at this back to school event that he did in Harlem,
mm-hmm. right?
And before we even get there, we've already seen how he's embraced it, and not the over the top and his canter embrace, where you could tell it's almost facetious and like he's too into it, but very measured. Like he came with a Dipset jersey at Vegas Summer League, and I think he said the right things, and I've liked how he's approached it, right? And his wife was there, so I spoke to his wife, and she, without even me prompting anything, she said, you don't understand, he's been talking about being at the Garden forever.
Really?
And it felt it really felt genuine. It didn't feel like, oh, you know, another guy is all campaigning to be in the Garden. She was like, you have no idea how much he's wanted this.
Yeah.
And he really does strike me as someone who, you know, found himself now in a situation that few players find themselves in. New York, LA, these crazy markets, crazy fans could propel you to like an insane level. We did it to KP.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We took KP to such a higher level than maybe his play deserved. Imagine Giannis here. Imagine Jokic going through what we would have been praising him like.
Right.
Julius Randle, you know, everybody wants to do well, become a star in the league. He's got a chance now where everything didn't fall the way people thought it would.
Yeah.
He's now in New York City, and he's the best player on the roster.
Yeah.
He's got a chance now to change how his career could go.
Facts. And that's what I was going to say. You're saying, like, everything didn't fall for us. Everything hasn't fallen for him.
Right. Yeah.
And if you think about it, and you think about it, too, like, his rookie year, he's really like a redshirt year. He got injured.
He got injured one game, I think,
the first game in.
Yeah.
Right? And every year, he's gotten better and better and better. Last year, 21 and 9.
Under the radar in a way, too,
under
right?
The radar.
Yeah.
Very under the radar. 21-9. Had a couple triple doubles last year, a couple 40-point games for the Pelicans last year.
45 on Enes Kanter.
Yeah.
Boom.
40% from three almost.
Yeah.
Close to it.
Exactly.
You know, so I think what happened was he fell into a lot of like bad situations. Like with the Lakers, he got better every year, but he fell into that free agency.
And
they were on the other tip for years.
They've been preparing LeBron. Like
they wanted
everything.
LeBron. They wanted Paul George. And I think also the emergence of Kuzma as being the more versatile stretch four that they were really looking for with LeBron coming in.
Right.
It kind of pushed him out in terms of getting that max bag from the Lakers.
Exactly. And if you really look, if you talk to some Laker fans, they'll say, like, damn, they regret letting
him go. They like Randle. Yeah.
They regret letting him go.
He's a good guy, too, man. Like, something about his vibe. Like, I go and put too much in this, but just watch. Watching him in Harlem with the kids, like, it really felt real and genuine. Like, he genuinely seems happy to be here. I don't think he understands how much New York's going to ride for him.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. You're talking about career opportunities lining up. We will make this guy a top five all-star vote getter. Like, that's what New York is.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
We will propel him. If he shows what we hope, if he comes in here 24-10, I want to see kind of like what we saw. I mean, I don't think he's this good yet. If you can kind of see what we saw from Stat in 2010 when he just came in.
That was monstrous.
Insane.
That
won,
like,
not that, all that level,
30,
but if you can give
points,
us. Yeah, it was insane. If you can give us some of that, the way we were like riding for Stat,
yeah.
Randall's gonna get the backing that he would have never gotten anywhere else.
Yeah,
we're hungry for a star. We're hungry for a guy. We're gonna. Man. That's why KP got it.
I don't know the numbers off the bat, but I remember reading that he had a very high usage rate and very high production rate at the same time. It wasn't some of these empty stats thing where he's like, oh, I put up 21,
right.
But I'm like 40. I'm like 38%. Like, no, he was actually very productive.
Yeah.
It's really just the defensive end where I feel like he has to kind of take that.
And the threes. I think he needs to show that he can really space that floor with Mitch, that the paint's not going to be all clogged up. The dimes, I think, are very formidable for a big man. He averaged 4 dimes, 3.8 dimes last season.
Yep. You got a power forward who could pass, finally.
Right. A power forward who could pass, right? So can he stretch the floor a little bit more?
Yeah.
And I think if he can do that, like you said, from the defensive end, if he can help be that spark, you know him and Mitch are going to be on the boards. That's one thing.
That's the thing. You got to love that we got. I mean, don't get me wrong. Shout out to Cantor with the rebounding at least.
Right.
But KP was a weak rebounder for years. We got guys now who can go out there and get boards. And Mitch got so much better near the end of last year, too.
That's a fact. And I think you hope he takes that next step. I read something that said he's actually looking at film, trying to figure out where he can improve on that side. But pairing Randall with Mitch is going to help him out so much. And like, I think they can be a really good one-two punch.
He said that position. Yeah. In the interview, like, I think Begley said something like, I got Mitch back there. That guy doesn't know how good he is. So he already sees what's happening.
Yeah.
Some Laker fans, you know, slate me for this, is Laker fans. The last year he was there in L.A. was probably his best defensive year, they said. Because I was kind of looking in to see what, like, you know, you don't remember stuff from years ago. Right, so I wanted to see what the fans were saying. They said he gave a lot of Draymond Green light vibes that year.
Yeah, Luke Walton gave him credit for that.
Yeah, and then he went to New Orleans and maybe fell off a bit. But it's like we said before, right? With these guys, is that balance. Elfrid Payton, we saw better defensively. His offense picked up a little bit, so his defense fell. Right. Randall, definitely the last 2 years, he's been focused on his game. He's expanded it so much, lost mad weight.
Yeah.
Dude is like cut.
Rich.
He's ripped. I saw him in person. I'm like, he looks... I don't want to say skinny, but he's lean. Like, he's not going to be this big, but he's going to be running. He's going to be doing everything. So, and he's still strong. So, he's definitely every year, bit by bit, chipped away. And now at 24, man, that's a great time to get him in. You know, you got him on a 2-year with the option. You're going to get him for maybe the best or either the best era of his career or like the second best time of his career, depending on how he is, late 20s. But I love the contract, man. You know, you could do much worse than getting Julius Randle after what happened this summer.
Definitely.
He's going to embrace it. I'm ready, man. I think this is going to be his best year of his
career. Yeah, man. I'm just hoping you get him at the right time because it's people who come up from other people and they go on a new team and they have potential here and they go on another team and they just hit that next thing. I'm just hoping.
Funny you said that, though, because if I could actually see Randall being that guy here.
Right.
Being like that's the good. One rare time where the Knicks actually got a guy who developed two other places, and then we got the benefit instead of us being the one
at the tail end.
Exactly.
Yeah. Tail end of the prime.
Right. We didn't get him at 28.
Right.
We got him at 24. And he's like a young vet. He got the right attitude. Right. Mm-hmm. And I mean, me and my mom was talking about this. He's married with a kid. That's good.
Oh, hey, settle down. You stay off these NY streets. Yeah. Don't be the alcohol.
Too litty.
No situation.
Yeah. I think you could also, like, my wild card lineup, right, could be.
Ooh, I want to hear it. I'm dying to hear this.
RJ at the 1.
Okay.
Dotson at the 2. Knox at the 3. Morris at the 4. Go Randall at the 5. Go small ball.
Yeah.
It'd be a nice little mix.
See, another thing we could talk about Mitch real quick is that people seem to already lock and expect Mitch to now be ready for 82 games.
Yeah.
Like, Mitch missed a month and like 6 weeks. Yeah. Durability is
always going to be a question for
his foul trouble. I saw him in summer league. He was being wild. Now, we do think he might have been playing around a bit because of summer league, but he was still being kind of wild.
You hope he doesn't regress because he showed promise at the end of last season.
That's the thing. With DeAndre, when that mentorship happened, he showed a lot. But, you know, it's still a big jump for him to go immediately now, the 82 games, 35 minutes
a game
starter.
I think we need to temper our expectations of Mitch.
Yeah, yeah, because we've been going crazy with Abion. We've all been going a little crazy with Mitch. Right. Like, he's going to come in 15 and 12, few blocks a game immediately. Like, he's still going to have some of the little struggles he had at times. Yeah. It's not going to be, you know, growth is not just that. It's up and down. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't be shocked to see a little small ball, Randall at the five, Morris at the four. Imagine him at the top, taking the center off the dribble.
Knox at the 3.
Yeah,
that's
man.
It's a big lineup, but it's still athletic enough. right. to get up and down the
yeah.
court.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it depends on the Magic, because I know he has problems with the post.
Yeah, I mean, listen, yes, he's always not that. He has short arms. He has trouble defending at the rim. I get it. I'm just saying in a spurt.
Yeah,
you know, he needs that offensive firepower. Yeah.
That's what, you know, just go back to Fizz. That's what I want to see from Fizz, right? I see the great teams to me always had ideas of spurts and lineups and timing. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I'm going to kill them right now with this 8-minute run. Mm-hmm. I got these guys for these 8 minutes I know I'm going to do. I want to see that, because to me that really shows that you know your team. Like that lineup you just brought up, right? I could see that lineup being insane for a six-minute stretch.
Right.
What if that's the third quarter? You know, we've had struggles in the third. So let's say we come out after 4 minutes in the third quarter. Boom, Fizz runs that out. Mm-hmm. Kill them before the fourth. And it works. That's the thing that's going to get me excited about Fizz and about the roster, because I think you got the parts to make things like that happen. Right. You got so many parts. You got everything.
Yeah,
it's like a build your own line of choose your own adventure. So if Fizz is doing it right, we're going to see him find these little pockets of like, oh, this little 3 minute spurt. I got this mad defensive line I could play. This mad scientist thing I could do. For this. I want to see that. That's going to get me so excited.
Yo, it's interesting. I was reading some article that was talking about Pelicans lineups. Pelicans lineups, and it had like They had Randall running the show and surrounded him with shooters.
I love that. I love that, man. Like, yeah.
And so, and seeing as we have like 600 shooting guards as well,
we can make it happen.
We can have a shooting guard. We can have a Zoe and Dot or Wayne or whatever.
Yeah.
Knox.
A lot of different ways.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. There's options, which is why I would be disappointed if I don't see. Because we talk about experimentation. We don't see him overdo it with just the in and out. But I do want to see him lock into some things that he believes in and makes sense. And I want to see him ride it through and not just change it because one thing went wrong. You know what I mean? Like, I love that line, people. That's interesting as hell, man.
It's a wild card, man.
That could be, mess some teams up. Golden State did it. How did Golden State hit their level? The small ball five death line. Yeah. That was literally it. When that happened, the league had to change to try to match it.
Mm-hmm.
D'Antoni back with Phoenix. You know what I mean? He figured out this with Barbosa and Nash. He had that in the backcourt sometimes, figuring some stuff out. Diab at the five. Like, Stott played five a lot too. So let's see. I want to see. Let's get to that, Fizz. We got the parts to do it.
All right, so that's to wrap up the first edition of the podcast live in studio. Downtown New York City, CP from Knicks Fan TV, my man JL's from Nick of Time Show, and special guests.
Terry,
appreciate you for coming,
my
dude.
That's me.
Appreciate you for coming.
I know I talk a lot, but I got a lot to say.
Hey, listen, baby. That's a passion in you, man. Yeah, that's a passion in you, man.
This is great. I had such a blast, guys. I know we're going to be doing this during the season, too, but a lot of questions. We're going to have you covered.
Absolutely.
Let's just say that. You don't have to worry. We're going to answer them as best we can.
So make sure you guys subscribe to the channels. Check out the other content below. And we check you guys next time, man. Peace.